This week on the Spotlight.
Human rights is, that's a good question.
Human rights. Well, that's a tough one.
Wow.
I don't even know how to give that a definition.
I would probably have to do a little bit of homework or something.
Any right that I think any, just as a normal, you know, human, any.
The rights that humans have.
That's a very large debate.
Non saprei, una domanda complicatissima.
Yes, we just take them for granted that they're there, but we don't even consider what they are.
We tackled the unethical breach of human rights and its effects on the LGBT community and racial minorities, from police brutality to racial profiling.
No justice!
No peace!
No justice!
No peace!
We will discuss these issues and get to the bottom of it all. I'm David Martinez. Join me and my co-host Ebony Harper as we tackle the issues of human rights today on The Spotlight.
Hello everyone, welcome to The Spotlight presented by the Youth Channel. We'd like to thank you for tuning in. I'm Ebony Harper, and this is my co-host, David Martinez.
What's up, everyone? And hello, Ebony. I came in here today ready to get this show going here. And I'm ready to get lit and get this party started. How you doing today, Ebony?
I am happy to be here to work with beside you, David.
Yes.
And as you know, we have some important topics to touch bases on.
Oh, yes, indeed. Now, you are aware of the issues from the past and the present of human rights.
Yes, I am.
Well, that's what we're going to be focusing on today, on how the disregard of human rights by police and other parts of society negatively impact the LGBT community and racial minorities. The very idea of human rights was solidified almost 70 years ago on December 10th, 1948.
70 years ago?
Yeah, 70 years ago. I remember buying a camera and then flash got me so bad. But 1948 is when that happened, and that was when the Declaration, Universal Declaration of Human Rights, a milestone document, was signed by the United Nations in Paris in the history of human rights.
Yes. And the Universal Declaration states that the civil and political rights, like the rights to liberty, freedom of speech, and privacy, are to be enjoyed by all people, no matter who you are or where you live. It also includes economic, social, and cultural rights, like the rights to social security, health, and education.
Yes, Ebony. And it's 30, there are 30 articles that form this declaration.
Now, what we want to talk about is whether or not human rights are being respected. David, do you believe people are still fighting for their human rights today, or they have just given up?
Well, Ebony, if you look at one side here, there you see that there are still many individuals that are fighting for their human rights here, just by having their voices heard and advocating for change. While if you look at the other side, on the other hand, there are some people that have given up for their rights just because others don't care and it's not affecting them and they just don't want change at all here.
Yes, you're right, David. I know one community that I'm very familiar with that's been fighting for years for their human rights. And I'm talking about the LGBT community.
The history of gays and lesbians in America has been largely hidden. Love expressed in secret, lives too often lived in the shadows. For generations, to be gay meant being forsaken by family, fired by employers, even risking arrest or forced hospitalization. Gay life and gay love, however, found a way. In cities across the country, gay people created their own families of friends and lovers, their own society and culture, which thrived. The notion of equal rights for gays and lesbians, however, seemed like a dream. In 1965, a man named Frank Kameny, who had been fired from his government job because he was gay, along with fellow activist Jack Nichols, picketed the White House in the nation's first major public gay protest.
Now, would you like to touch up on that?
Oh, yes. Speaking of the LGBT community here, even though many have disbelief and follow different lifestyles, they all fight for the singular cause of having their human rights respected. And when I mean respected, I mean R-E-S-P-E-C-T. You better know what it means to me.
Yes, 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 yes. And this has made the LGBT community in the recent years fight even harder for their equal representation, eventually resulting to the recognition of gay marriage as a legal form of marriage almost in 50 states. Can you believe that?
I can't believe it.
However, the fights for the gay rights are still facing many hurdles, and they have a long way to go. But I would love to touch a little bit more on gay marriage. Now, we all know in the year of 2013 of June, gay marriage was recognized on the federal level as a legal form of marriage after the Supreme Court ruling U.S. versus Winston. Now, what happened after that case of 2013?
Well, after that 2013 case, 70, we should all understand that there were only 14 states where same-sex marriage had not been legalized in the United States until later on. And then this case faced many hurdles on a state level due to the opposition of conservative groups, leading to state-level bans on gay marriage.
However, since June of 2015, following the rule of another Supreme Court case, gay marriage has become the legal nationwide overturning the state's legal bans. Wow.
Yeah, and now I'm so glad that gay marriage was just legalized in the United States, because we ought to thank our very good president, Barack Obama.
Yes.
He signed the bill and made gay marriage legal in all 50 states to the United States. So we want to thank you, President Obama, for making this happen. And now, as much as the gay marriage was a big accomplishment for the LGBT community, I'm just a little worried now, because there is one particular person who has been fighting against LGBT rights that I cannot stand. And this person happens to be the current Vice President, Mike Pence.
I understand. We all know Pence has become the face of LGBT community and the discrimination after signing a bill to allow businesses to discriminate and deny service to the LGBT people because of who they are and whom they love. What are your views on Pence's decision of the LGBT community?
Okay, let me just say, which camera am I on? Am I on this? Oh, this one? All right. Let me just say and ask you, Mr. Vice President Pence, do you even know what love is? Do you even know the meaning of the blues? Or do you not even care about the LGBT community and their rights? Have you ever heard of Teddy Pendergrass's song, "To Be Free, To Be Who We Are"? I mean, this man is just out of control and out of his mind to limit LGBTQ rights. Like, come on, man. It's not gonna work.
Unfortunately, that's not even worse. Like, it gets worse than that.
Oh, my God.
Now, we all know Mike Pence was also known for supporting the conversion of the therapy. And as a member of the Congress, he even said that marriage of equality can lead to societal collapse and called homosexuality a choice.
So was it a mistake to sign this law?
Absolutely not. The Religious Freedom Restoration Act was signed into federal law by President Bill Clinton more than 20 years ago. And it lays out a framework for ensuring that a very high level of scrutiny is given anytime government action impinges on the religious liberty of any American.
Who appeared with you when you signed the bill, Eric Miller of Advance America, wrote that it will protect those who oppose gay marriage. He put up this example. He said, Christian bakers, florists, and photographers should not be punished for refusing to participate in a homosexual marriage. So this is a yes or no question. Is Advance America right when they say a florist in Indiana can now refuse to serve a gay couple without fear of punishment?
Well, let me explain to you. The purpose of this bill is to empower, and has been for more than 20 years, George. This is not speculative. The purpose of this legislation, which is the law in all 50 states in our federal courts, and it's the law by either statute or court decisions in some 30 other states, is very simply to empower individuals when they believe that actions of government impinge on their constitutional First Amendment freedom of religion. This is not about discrimination. This is about empowering people to confront government overreach, George.
Let me try to pin you down on it, because your supporters say it would. And so yes or no, if a florist in Indiana refuses to serve a gay couple at their wedding, is that legal now in Indiana?
George, this is where this debate has gone with misinformation and frankly,
it's just a question, sir. Yes or no?
Well, there's been shameless rhetoric about my state and about this law and about its intention all over the internet.
Okay. A little help here. I mean. This man, he does not know what he's doing. And on a side note to this, he had to find a partner in crime that I also cannot stand at all. And he happens to be Trump's Attorney General cabinet nominee, Jeff Sessions. I mean, he spent 20 years in the Senate trying to limit the LGBTQ rights. And according to AmericanPress.com.org, I need a breather here. But he voted a constitutional ban on same-sex marriage. I'm sorry I spit, but this is a fact, and he's killing me here. But he also voted a law against a law that stopped bosses from hiring employees based on sexual identity. This man is crazy. Like, what are your thoughts on what Jeff Sessions is doing here? Like, what does it mean for the LGBT community and for everyone else?
Well, David, the only thing I can tell you is that it definitely doesn't mean any good, especially because his role as Attorney General of the Trump's administration, as Attorney General, Sessions will have the power to overturn any law that helps the Supreme Court, which is now the Congress of Justice elected by Trump's, giving him the power to overturn the gay marriage laws, destroying all the strives.
That's what I'm afraid of here.
Now, I'm afraid of that too. And also, according to the Center for American Progress, 1 in 10 lesbian, gay, bisexual workers reported being fired from their jobs in the last 5 years due to the sexual orientation of their identity.
Oh, come on. I mean, that's ridiculous.
It is ridiculous. And nearly 1 in 3 transgender experience serious workplaces discrimination on the basis of their gender and identity in the last year alone.
Okay, here's the thing. Why do you have to limit their rights in the workplace discrimination? Like, that is just ridiculous and plain wrong and dumb. Like, why do you have to fire people just because, well, if you fill out an application, they give you a male, female, and transgender, like, you're aware of that, aren't you?
Yeah,
but why do we have to put that down if we are the ones that are applying for this job and we have the skills and experience? Like, we should not be without prejudice just because of that. That is just completely wrong of what Jeff Sessions and the Trump administration is doing.
You know? Yeah, sadly. Mm-hmm. However, form of prejudice is not just directed towards the LGBT community, but it's also towards the minority of our nations and society. Now, the study shows that the police are more likely to pull over and frisk blacks and Latinos than whites.
I've been stopped by police after I became a cop. I used to walk to Washington Heights with two other cops, friend of mine, and we would got thrown against the wall just for walking down. I'm not saying don't stop the criminal. I say don't stop the innocent people.
Study shows that police are more likely to pull over and frisk blacks and Latinos than whites. In New York City, 80% of the stops were made between the blacks and the Latinos, and 80% was frisk, compared to the 8 mayor of white people.
I can't believe it.
I could believe it. And not only that, in 2010, the U.S. Census, the commission reported that the African Americans received 10% longer sentences than the whites through the federal systems for the same crime. Now, have you ever seen any type of abuse in a community that's dealing with the...
Well, before I get into that, I tell you, those numbers that we saw, they're just too high, I'll tell you this. But to answer your question, though, I personally have never been the victim of police brutality, thankfully. But however, I had know and I've seen this happen when I'm watching the news. Like, what was the name of the case? It was when there was a show, was it Eric Garner?
Yes.
Yeah, it was Eric Garner and many other different cases as well that I've seen that has had this issue as well, where it's just completely wrong what the police is doing. Like, they're just after the money and they just want to help people just stay inside or, but anyway, I'm losing my train of thought, but we've had a long discussion, Ebony, here, and we're going to have, our mouths are dry, my throat is dry, and I'm pretty sure we need water, aren't we? So we'll be right back with more on this discussion here. Whew.
Yo, this is a story about human rights. For those that don't know, you need to. Yo, a starving artist, but his lyrics sold worldwide. His friend and manager was a snake in disguise, and he was bitten. His song sold without his permission. Saw his record on the shelf, the snake had stolen his vision. But knowing his rights, he could protect himself. Fair treatment by fair courts, he got the law to help. The other dude just sunk weak, looked like a punk. Could hardly open his mouth to speak, popping that junk. You better get up, stand up, if you've been done wrong. You better stand up for your rights like that Marley song. Get yourself represented, lawfully defended. Know your human rights. Don't ever surrender. No, don't ever surrender. Yeah.
Let's go.
Hello, welcome back to the Spotlight here on the U Channel, and we want to continue our conversation on human rights. Now, economic inequality has become one of the greatest social diseases of our time, threatening the human rights of all people.
Indeed. Hi, welcome back. I've recovered from that last segment over Pence, Trump, and Sessions. Well, I don't even care about them, but I've recovered here. And did you go through a wardrobe change during the break?
Yeah. I had to, you know, get all glamour up. I look cute, you know.
You're looking good, girl. I can't believe you had to do a wardrobe change while I was in Africa.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. But what you did say, Ebony, is true, because I can't believe it myself, but I didn't know about this either, because 80 of the richest people on the planet now own as much as bottom half of the world's population. Now, did you know about this?
No, I didn't.
Neither did I at all. But in fact, 7 out of 10 people live in countries where the gap between the rich and poor is greater than it was 30 years ago.
This is very discouraging, David, because of Article 22 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, everyone is entitled to their realization of the economics, social and cultural rights dispensable for the her or his dignity. Now, what's your thoughts on that? What you think?
Well, we have to understand here that everyone has to understand what Article 22 says, because you have to look at that everyone, and I mean everyone, is entitled.
Yes.
They're entitled to realization of the economic, social, and cultural dispense. And we also have to understand that the human rights movement as a whole has been so slow to address the implications of this alarming trend and everything else that we have seen today here. And unfortunately, I can hear my agent calling me around the globe and on the other side here. So we're gonna have to go to another break here, and I'll speak to my agent as well. You are watching The Spotlight on the Youth Channel.
We'll be right back. Again, back on The Spotlight.
Welcome back here.
Yes. And now, to close up, we would like to share with you 5 steps that you can take in order to fight for our human rights on behalf of yourself and others. Mm-hmm. Number one, inform yourself and others about how human rights matter. Read and share the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. You can make a video with your friends talking about why you believe human rights matter.
Mm-hmm. I definitely agree with that, because we both should make like do a Facebook Live video or a Skype video and just speak to the people who are in the human rights community that are going through these issues around. Like, have them to tell their story on what they've experienced in the human rights.
Yes,
here.
Yes, by the way.
So I do agree with that. Second thing, number two, speak up when another person's rights are at risk or under attack. If you see someone being harassed, bullied, or ridiculed on public street, on public transportation, on the street, while shopping, or at school, or anywhere in the public, just stand with them. Stand with them, I say. Use social media to stand with people who are facing reprisals for defending human rights at work, around the dinner table, at school, around the house, anywhere in particular. Help someone whose voice is rarely heard to share their views and opinions.
Yes, mm-hmm. And I definitely can agree with that, because it's nothing best than having a group and a team to work so we all can have a voice as one.
Yes, we all have to work as a team to stand up for human rights, even in the communities as well.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Not only that, number three, stand with other human rights movements. Donate to organizations that support victims of human rights abuse, and join public events in support of human rights as well. You can also volunteer with a group and promote human rights defenders.
Exactly. We also, so at the end of the show, you and I are going to volunteer and stand with the communities
oh,
for
yes.
human rights.
I don't mind doing that. Yes.
Because we have to. Other people are out to real, other celebrities are, so why not we join as well?
Yes, you know? I think, and another thing, I think we need to really partake as a human race, and we need to have a voice and speak out. Let's have a voice for other people, everybody, not just us, just for everybody
exactly.
who have different beliefs.
Yeah, so and yes. just tell their story, that's all. Number four, we should call on leaders to uphold human rights. Urge your community's leaders to make public commitments to human rights.
Yes, I mean, having a leader to speak for all of us, that I feel like that will work. We don't need a group. Sometimes we need that person who could take us and, you know, mm-hmm. be the voice for all of us.
Yeah, we need a leader to lead the groups to where we want to be in human rights.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And there's one more.
Yes, there's one more. And the last one, but not least, combat myths with facts in online or daily conversations.
Yeah, that's another thing we should yes. also do. And in addition to that, we also have to speak up for tolerance and against prejudice.
Yes.
Keep yourself in check. And that's what we all have to do as a community. Challenge your own views and prejudices. And that's one thing of the things we have to keep in mind here as we go along and to fight human rights and to have our rights expanded, not limited.
Not only that, I feel like we should fight the hate because we don't need more hate. You understand? Mm-hmm. We need more good. So as long as we fight for the right thing, then we will always go down the right path. And let's just say no to the negative and let's say yes to positive.
Yes, because we all want peace on this earth. No racism in America. We just want peace. Why can't we all just get along as a community and as a nation?
Yes, and come united.
Exactly, because reunited just feels so good rather than just fighting each other because of whatever the issue is, you know? And so, those are the actions we have for you to stand up for human rights here. And I gotta say, Ebony, it was big and wild, but this is all that we have for our discussion today. It's been one roller coaster ride, I know.
Yes, it has.
With human rights. And we wanna thank you for tuning in to the spotlight here. And it's always been a pleasure working with you, Ebony, as always.
Yes, it's always been a pleasure to work with you as well, David. Mm-hmm. And we also would like to thank you for joining us on the spotlight. Subscribe to the youth channel on YouTube. Like and follow the youth channel on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram.
Oh, yes. And once again, thank you all to our viewers for watching the second episode of The Spotlight here. Any final words, Ebony, before we leave?
Well, I would just like to thank the youth channel for allowing us, you know, to display and actually speak on behalf of our youth. So,
oh, yes. That's a good thing. You know, I thought you had nothing to say at all here. Okay, but I'm David Martinez, and this is one of the people I always enjoy working with. My lovely and talented co-host, Ebony Harper. I enjoy working with her as always here. And until then, good luck, be well, be safe, and then we will see you on the spotlight.